All right, let's get started. Today is VCU, Department of Internal Medicine, Graham Browns. Today is Thursday, December 14, 2023. Today's session is sponsored by the Division of Gastroenterology, Hepatology, and Nutrition, and is going to be an update on the Stravitz-Sanyal Institute for Liver Disease from Dr. Arun Sanyal. So Dr. Sanyal serves as the chair of the Division of Gastroenterology, Hepatology, and Nutrition here at VCU and is the current director for the Stravitz-Sanyal Institute for Liver Disease and Metabolic Health. Dr. Sanyal is professor of medicine, physiology, and molecular pathology. He received his medical degree at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences in New Delhi in 1983, completed residency in internal medicine at Texas Tech University, and then a fellowship in gastroenterology here at VCU before joining the faculty in 1989. I won't have time to go into all the details of his CV, but a couple highlights. His research interests are in all aspects of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, as well as complications of cirrhosis and end-stage liver disease. He has served in several leadership roles nationally and globally. He has published over 1,000 publications in pristine journals such as Cell Metabolism, Nature, Medicine, New England Journal of Medicine, Lancet, and others. He's recently been cited as having been, he's been cited by databases as have been cited over 100,000 times in his works. And recently by Scholar GPS, which covers a database of over 30 million scholars in over 200 countries worldwide. He has received the latest rankings of number 2 in 3 major areas: liver disease, alcohol-related, and non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And he has a lifetime overall ranking of number 5 in hepatology in general. He is has been on the Clarivate's list of the world's most influential researchers since 2017. Dr. Sanyal's leadership here at the VCU in hepatology and gastroenterology was an inspiration for this transformative $100 million gift by a friend and long-term colleague, Dr. Stravitz, which has now funded the Stravitz-Sanyal Institute. So today we're hearing the second update since the Institute's start last year. So Dr. Sanyal, if you come up and give us your insight, thank you.
Microphone is here, video is there. Perfect. So thank you, everyone. It's really a pleasure to give you an update on everything that's been going on. It's been a busy couple of years. Let's see, how do I advance this?
Click down, should work.
No. Click down, there you go. Here are my disclosures. Okay. I once again, you know, just like we did last time, I want to start by reminding everybody that the strengths in liver disease here at VCU didn't just start yesterday. We have a long legacy. And this is a photo of Dr. Reno Vlahcevic, who was division chief when I came here as a fellow. He was my mentor. And he was really an amazing human being and created an environment where so many people succeeded. And it's easy to look good when you stand on the shoulders of giants. In the early days, we started working on tips. And this is something that those of you in internal medicine, especially if you're in the ICUs, you know, we use pretty much on a regular every day, every week basis. But the story and the evidence base for how this is used around the world started here. And this was our early work. It wasn't just about me. So there's an entire slew of faculty who have made major contributions that basically define how hepatology is practiced around the world. So in that background, Todd really helped me formalize this idea that we need to create a legacy platform that will allow not only the benefits that we, you know, had growing up under Dr. Vlahcevic's mentorship, for this to continue long after we are gone, and to also revolutionize. We, looking back, thinking about with minimal resources, how we have changed the practice of medicine worldwide. We want that to continue because that really is why we joined the academic mission in the first place. So we started with this idea that we would dream the impossible dream, that we would actually revolutionize liver care to improve health, not just with the patient in front of us, but around the world. We would have the ability to make these dreams a reality, build on our resilience, because I can tell you without resilience, we would not have made it this far. And without forgetting that we must have empathy for all the people around us through every step of the way. And to establish a sustainable platform to launch and sustain future generations of care providers and investigators. How are we going to do this? The first thing we wanted to do was to make sure that everything we do starts with our patients. They are at their reason, they are the reason why we exist. So we must start with our patients. And as I tell all the people I have trained, that when you go to medical school, you read textbooks of medicine to learn medicine. When you get into the real world, you won't have the time to read those big textbooks. But every time you walk into a patient's room and you talk to the patient, you have an opportunity because there's a live textbook of medicine that's reading back to you. It's up to you to listen and learn from the patients. So it starts with the patient. They'll tell you what is the important question that you need to focus on. And so this shows sort of our general structure, how we set this up 30 years ago when we started the liver program here, where we had this idea that we would have a two-tier clinic system. Everybody would do some general hepatology, but each faculty member would have a niche area that they would be the point person for and develop a level of expertise that would be unparalleled in the world. And all of us would support that individual in that specific area that they were working on. And this is the reason why Richard Sterling, working on viral hepatitis, has made huge contributions. Todd made contributions in acute liver failure. Vlahcevic became a stalwart in chronic cholestatic liver disease, and so on and so forth. And Jazz working on encephalopathy, and Shadab now working on the liver-heart connection. So this is sort of at the core of how we have always operated. A principal thing that we focus on is metabolic health. Now, these are data that are downloaded from the CDC just about 6 weeks ago or 8 weeks ago. And essentially what you see is that we have a major problem in the United States. These are just data from 2020 to 21. And we see that life expectancy decreased by 0.6 years within the span of 1 year. And the age-adjusted death rate increased by 5%. That is alarming. If anybody is not alarmed by these data, they should be. And it occurred across every age group. And if you look at the top 10 things driving this, they're all linked to metabolic health. And liver disease, of course, is also part of this story. And there is a common thread that goes through all of this. And so one of our key goals was to leverage the central role of the liver as a determinant of metabolic health, because liver is one of the largest metabolic organs in the body. And it is linked, there's now a huge body of literature linking it to neurocognitive decline, cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, and chronic kidney disease. And so this is a specific area of focus, and we have now sort of built this out, as shown over here, to really be able to provide holistic care, not just thinking about patients in terms of the organs as one organ at a time, but really thinking of the patient and making sure we're looking at all the competing risks to the patient in a holistic manner and addressing it in a way that makes sense. This shows how we currently practice medicine. If you think about people who are healthy, they become metabolically unhealthy, which is largely linked to excess adiposity and the current epidemic of obesity. They develop clinically silent end organ diseases, which then progress to clinically obvious diseases. Now, if you look at your textbook of medicine, they're all focused on clinically obvious diseases. That's how we learn medicine. That's how, you know, for the last 200 years, medicine has been practiced. So we wait till we have clinically obvious disease. We intervene at that point, but frequently it's okay if it's an infection and you cure the infection. But for these chronic diseases, all we are doing is putting a Band-Aid. So if you look at the cost, we're spending about $230 billion for cardiovascular disease, $300 billion for diabetes, and so on and so forth. Imagine if you could develop a new paradigm of medicine where you could shift the needle leftwards and actually come in with 20% of the cost and reduce all this morbidity and mortality. So that's sort of the vision of what we're trying to do. How are we going to do it? With a strong focus on translational science and translational medicine. The days where you have silos, where the health system thinks their only job is to see patients, generate RVUs and money, and the academics are off in some other garage, you know, doing their own thing, that's behind us. We have a choice at VCU, whether we want to be those second tier institutions where we cannot distinguish, you know, that these missions are really interlinked, or we can be in front of this wave that is coming, where clinical care and clinical research are not separate things within academic centers. They are seamlessly integrated. And you do that through translation. Translation from discovery science to preclinical testing, getting things to humans, bringing eventually drugs to market, then focusing on access to care. Eventually, that is what it's going to take to improve population health and to improve, you know, shift the needle on the ground. We already have deep strengths in each and every one of these buckets, and we can build on this. And so that's the vision. And at the center of this integration process between clinical care and our research engine is our biorepository, because you can do in silico, you can do animal studies, you can do all of that molecular stuff, but it doesn't, 90% of the time, it doesn't translate into humans. So we're spending a lot of energy in research models that are not translating. So if you really want to impact humans, you need to study humans, which means you need to have a robust biorepository connected to clinical metadata that allows us to do that kind of translational research and bridge the clinical care to the to research. So, you know, we have a research engine, you have a clinical engine, the biorepository allows us to connect these two, which allows us to do discovery science, which allows us to identify novel therapeutic targets, biomarkers. We bring them into trials and then eventually work with regulatory agencies like FDA, et cetera, to meet the evidence burden, to be able to say, yes, this works. No, this does not work. And this is how you use it. So then it goes into the guidelines once it, and then you change practice. And then you have to make sure, you have to work with third-party payers that people actually have access to all of those fantastic new developments. So we, for us as academics, that there's a need to have people working on each and every one of those buckets. Otherwise, we're not going to shift the needle on the ground. And so from organizational structure, we have a matrix where we have, you know, on one side, scientists working on metabolism, inflammation, fibrosis, cancer, et cetera. On the other side, we have the technology course with molecular gene editing, animal science, data science, microbiome, clinical imaging, digital. And then far right are the actual disease states and the patients who have specific type of diseases. And of course, to do all of this, you need a very robust administrative core that understands the mission. You can't do this by yourself. This requires a team. And really, the future of medicine is team science. And so we not only are collaborating with people across VCU, but we're developing technology with partners from around the world. We've got academic partners around the world, and we have established global outposts in different parts of the world. And I'll go into this in a minute. And at each step, this provides us opportunities to educate. So there are all the way from high schools to partner universities or in the vicinity to other VCU schools to our global partners. We can provide hands-on experience, collaborations, and a slew of educational opportunities from certificate programs all the way to PhDs, et cetera. So the vision for a lot of this type of stuff is that we are going to keep building on the education. So we have, for example, established a collaboration with the University of Sao Paulo, where a lot of people from VCU went down. And the idea is that together we will build a global community of investigators who can work together so that what we are learning here can be translated to people all around the world. All right. So talk is cheap, right? So in the end, you have to show what have you actually done with really in, you know, concrete terms. So what I'm going to do now in the second part of the talk is to show you what has happened in the last 18 months and talk about the infrastructure, the clinical programs, research, education, our collaborations, et cetera. So first thing we had to do was to staff up because, you know, given the vision that we laid out, there's no way one person can do it, right? You need a team. So we have now pretty much hired all of the key individual people who are going to be managing these different activities. And we'll go into this in a minute. So the Chief Operating Officer, Erica Malkasian, was hired in November 22, about a year ago. It was only a year ago. And when I made this slide, it seemed like she's been here forever now because we've gone through so much in 1 year that it seems we've known each other for so long, but it's only been a year. Brooke Hayes has only been here as the Chief Operations Director since October of 22, and she was the GI Administrator for a year before that. So only been here for 2 years. Richard Sterling has joined as the Chief Clinical Officer for the Liver Institute. We have a communications director. We have a finance manager. We have additional research collaborators. And we have a number of people where their hires pending. And I'm very pleased to say that the last one, the chief scientific officer, that position is now filled. Dr. Saul Karpin, who is the incoming president of the American Association for Study of Liver Diseases, will be joining us here as the chief scientific officer. And he will be here in March. And we're absolutely thrilled. So he comes with a lot of academic expertise and big picture, big vision, and we're absolutely thrilled to have him join us. Now, what have we done in terms of clinical space? So those are all the staffing up things that we've done. And remember, this is all in the last 18 months that all of these positions have been filled. So on inpatient side, I'm very pleased to inform everyone that working closely with the health system and with the transplant program, the seventh floor of the main hospital is being renovated to largely accommodate the growth in the volume of liver patients who are coming to VCU. As we know, this year we're on target to approach close to 200 liver transplants. Of course, that means we have a lot of patients with very sick livers that we take care of, that you guys all take care of on an everyday basis. And so we need space to accommodate that. And so that's underway probably in 25, this will open. Outpatient, we are working with, again, the health system on renovating AOP9. The design phase has started and we are expecting, it was overly optimistic. We thought it would start in July of 24. The reality is probably going to be first quarter of 25 as well. So we've had a series of meetings with VCU health facilities, engineers, architecture. I've learned more about architecture and engineering than I ever wanted to. But anyway, we're on the way and it will have an incredible slew of functionalities that will be really quite state of the art. We've had incredible clinical growth while we're waiting for even new space and new quarters. You know, our program. So for those of you who are not that familiar with what we provide, we already have established programs on fatty liver disease, decompensated cirrhosis that feeds the transplant program, the hepatocellular carcinoma, which is a very well-established multi-stakeholder, multidisciplinary clinic. This year, we're on target to see over 600 new patients with hepatocellular carcinoma. That's a lot of patients with hepatocellular carcinoma. We have just started a dedicated cholestatic liver disease multidisciplinary clinic that Dr. Asim is running. I'm very pleased that we are finally moving into rare diseases, and we have set up the sarcoid hepatology clinic, and this is a collaboration with Dr. Vaishali Patel from hepatology and the critical and the pulmonary division who have managed this very large population of sarcoid patients. We would love to get into cystic fibrosis next. I'm pleased to tell you that we now have clinical trials using genetic therapies for Wilson disease and alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. And of course, we have a post-transplant clinic, et cetera. We've also set up a post-discharge clinic to reduce readmissions to the hospital for patients who particularly come in with ascites and decompensated liver disease. So we're trying to get all our patients who are getting discharged seen on the outpatient side within a couple of weeks to make sure that things don't unravel and then end up back in the hospital. And because readmission rates is a quality metric, and we do want to make sure we keep our readmission rates down at as low as possible. We've already started ramping up on the integration with research through biorepository. We're moving towards more protocolized care. We're working, and we expect this aspect to grow, which is working with a number of groups to introduce technology into the way we practice medicine, because we don't have the manpower, woman power, just these human resources to get everything we want done. And this is an opportunity to use technology to leverage these. And of course, the deliverables are shown on the right. Future plans, I would love to see a dedicated formal liver program within the women's health program. This is an underserved area, and we already have fellows and faculty who are interested in this. We just need to formalize this. So this is an important, for me, it is really one of the areas that I really want to build out. And that would make us the first program in the country, to my knowledge, that would have a dedicated women's health and liver disease and transplant program. The clinical growth, so we've had this incredible growth already, and we have reached out, and now we have a ring of referring clinics around Richmond, and we're working closely with the transplant program to continue to enhance this. Now, normally in an academic meeting, we don't talk about money. And it's sort of a dirty word, right? But sometimes it's good to stop and actually remind ourselves of how much we are actually contributing to the fiscal mission of the institution, because there is a reality of no money, no mission. So this shows the operating margin for hepatology. So here, I would like to take a little bit of credit, because if it went the other way, it would also be on me. And you can see in 2020, when I took over here, we managed to just stem the tide. And then we turned it around in 21. And in 22, through EPIC, we had some issues, but our annualized 23 margin looks extremely healthy. So we do bring a lot to the health system to support a lot of different missions. And we are continuing to work to establish the care pathway. And this is sort of, we've mapped out how our patients flow through our system, and we are putting in audits and dashboards. So at each step, we can make sure that the quality of what we are doing is as good as we think it should be. And this also gives us a roadmap for identifying what is working well what is not working well, so we can do a causal analysis and make it better. And we talk a lot about an active learning environment from a health system perspective, where we are continuously evaluating what's working well, what's not working well. I've seen a lot of talk over the last 20 years, but here we're actually beginning to implement this. And this, we believe, will be a model, not only for the rest of the health system, but nationally as well. So in terms of moving on to research, we've established our research space. We're rapidly, you know, building up beyond the biorepository to create and set ourselves up with technologies that will allow us to do state-of-the-art research going forward. And we are staffing up accordingly. The future is all about data. And so, you know, we are spending a lot of resources in building out the infrastructure to take our data sources, aggregate them, manage the data, build in the analytics, and have the ability to visualize the output and learn from it and do causal analyses so that we can actually learn from this and then implement additional solutions to make things better and have a way to evaluate the impact of the changes we make. So this is incredibly important if we're going to be focused on improvement without wasting a lot of time doing things that don't make sense. We're building unique technology capabilities, and this is one example of that. This is a company called HistoIndex based in Singapore who have now established, this is the first academic center that actually has second harmonic generated imaging capability. And while we started with the liver, this can go to lung, to heart, to many other organ systems as well. And we've already got a major NIH study underway based on this very unique resource. We're scaling up our biorepository, and we have hired a dedicated biorepository director. Very pleased to have Jennifer Sain join us. She has a long history of running the biorepository for Illumina, for their national biorepository. And prior to that, setting up the biorepository for UT Southwestern's Comprehensive Cancer Center. So absolutely, we have the right people, we have resources, and now we're building that infrastructure up. Key is biorepository is not just some blood and urine sitting in a freezer. It has to be linked to metadata. We are going to scan every liver biopsy in for patients who have signed a consent. So we have a research image warehouse of histology, radiology, biosamples connected to clinical metadata. And we're building out our freezer farm. Of course, there's a lot of work that is going on to make sure we have data security, we can ensure the integrity of what's in there and what comes out, sample management and SOPs and the staffing and things that go into this. One of our main strengths, and we're very proud of this, is what we're doing with imaging. So one of our goals is to be a state-of-the-art unit for development and use of imaging for the study of physiologic and pathologic processes in humans with a focus on liver and metabolic disorders, but available to all researchers across VCU. And we are looking to get a state-of-the-art MRI, which will also have 13C and phosphorus imaging capabilities. And this would be one of three in the United States and the first on the East Coast with all of these capabilities. And also a PET CT scanner, which basically can scan the entire body in 72 seconds. So you can actually study physiology and inter-organ crosstalk in real time, in humans. This is something that was unimaginable in the past. And we will be uniquely positioned to be able to do that. So if you're a trainee listening to this, this is where you need to be, because this is the future. And we have tools that nobody else has. So as you know, it's an old saying, the boy with the most toys wins at the end of the day. So we have all the best toys. This will be an infrastructure to allow investigator-initiated research, development of new methodologies, to do proof of mechanism studies, for clinical trials. For example, we are working on now with our partners to develop imaging for to capture fibrogenesis across multiple organs. And so hopefully these will translate and give us new ways of assessing whether your heart, your lungs, your kidneys, your liver are scarring down, how the liver disease is affecting the brain and causing neurocognitive decline. We're getting novel insights using these type of technologies, showing that whereas we always thought the brain lives on glucose, that when you become severely insulin resistant and diabetic, your brain cannot use glucose and has to burn fat. And that produces a lipotoxic stress. And what is happening in the liver in NASH recapitulates in the brain and is linked to this neurocognitive decline, a completely new way of thinking about the neurocognitive decline that we see in our diabetes. And this, of course, provides incredible opportunities for training and education, not only for our faculty and residents, but all the way down to students across our ecosystem through hands-on training, image analytic methodology, radiotracer chemistry, regulatory science, radiomics. We are in conversations with Siemens to develop a training program in radiomics using their engineering and AI expertise and our clinical expertise so that it becomes synergistic. And we have gone through this incredible process to figuring out the layout. This is going to be on AOP9, and we hope this, along with our clinical infrastructure, will allow us to get to the finish line in time by 25. A lot of different partner updates. You know, we talked about Siemens, we talked about Histo Index and Second Harmonic. Another one is Takeda, with whom we have multiple work plans that are going on with a very strategic sort of idea about developing new science around fibrosis and disease progression. And then I want to talk a little bit about Target. So in the early days of when hepatitis C drugs were approved, there was a lot of concern about whether this would really impact anything in terms of public health. And Target was developed at University of Florida and UNC to really address and provide real world evidence of what's going on, and has been so influential in guiding the health policy and creating access to care that they work now closely with FDA, and they are now, there's a Target study for all kinds of diseases, including now long COVID. So essentially we're collaborating with Target and be able to use their technology to take our data sources and put it through this analytical program in using a web deployed, user interface that will allow us to do causal inferences in real time from our own patient data, and to be able to look into comparative research and interactive population health research. This will be a unique first, nationally and worldwide. And once we get actually do it, this has been a really long journey. I won't say it has been easy. In fact, probably one of the most challenging things we have done over the last 2 years, but we are continuing to make progress. And if we can actually get this all the way to the finish line, this will be an incredible resource for everybody in the entire ecosystem and for trainees who want to do research. We've set up a global footprint. We already have now 5 established formal memoranda of understanding with major academic centers around the world, as they're listed over here. And as you can see, they literally form a belt around the world. And so we are extending our reach beyond Virginia. So when people talk about being the best in Richmond or best in Virginia, my answer to them is always, we want to be the best in the world. And by definition, that means you have the best in Virginia as well. So that's what we are hoping to. And we've got programs. This is not just MOUs that are documents that sit on a shelf. In April of 24, we have a formal academic skills workshop that we are doing for trainees from all over India who are going to come to this center in West Bengal, where we are working with them. For Sao Paulo, next in March, 20 diabetologists and hepatologists from Brazil will come for intense 1-week training here at VCU around the role of the liver in metabolic health. And we're going to develop a faculty exchange. The first set will happen in 25. This is National University of Singapore. We just signed the MOU last week. And we did a joint course with over almost 1,000 attendees. And the next one is planned for 24. We already have a plan for fellows to come here and spend a year with us to learn research methodologies and go back. The first person who came here, and I'd like to really point out over here, Mark Mutaya, who came here as a fellow, spent a year with us. And since he has gone back 3 years ago, he has over 100 publications and literally just got a $5 million grant as well. So you know, it can show that this is not just words. We are actually transforming the world. And similarly, we have a collaboration in Turkey as well, the big focus around clinical trials and microbiome research. So we are building a global cohort over 100,000 patients in collaboration with all these centers, but also working very closely with the government of Mexico through a number of agencies in Mexico and to really understand the spectrum of metabolic health. All of the things that you all know, such as diabetes, cardiovascular disease, 5 times worse when you go to Mexico. So there are parts of the world which are hotspots for these type of disorders. And we're working very closely with them so that we can learn what's different about them. Why are they worse? Is it just simply genetics? What else is going on? And so on and so forth. Of course, all of this requires marketing and communication. AJ Hofstetter is our communications director. And so we've now got a whole slew of social media presence that we did not have. And we are going to soon have a piece on PBS as part of something called Medical Stories. So we set out with a fairly ambitious timeline with multiple milestones. But what we thought was very ambitious for 3 years, turns out we've pretty much done all of it in 18 months. So now we have to come up with more work to do. You know, I won't say that it's all easy and rosy, but you know, this is when you do something big, there are always challenges. And that's what makes this all interesting. So we look forward to continuing to work with the health system, the university, and all other stakeholders to continue to actualize the vision. And I hope I've given you a broad sense of how active and dynamic the program is and how much is going on really that you may not hear about on an everyday, day-to-day basis. So I want to finish by saying, while we've been doing all of this, it's not all been grunt work. We also want to have a little fun. So we'll finish with this.
My eyes go and ears. I deliver how I pass stage 2. My breasts is from the liver biopsy. He had the monster rash.
It's not called MASH.
It's called only MASH. He had the monster rash. It was the monster rash. The monster in its lair to the east. And the vampires in holes were set to east. On foods where I held a choice in the bound. The table was a MASH battleground. He had the monster rash. It caught on in the MASH. The monster bash. I mean, it's for the party that just begun. Yes.
So, anyway, this is Brooke Hayes and AJ's brainchild. I'd like to take credit for it, but it's really not mine to take. But anyway, what I hope I've shared with all of you is that we not only had a vision, but we're acting on the vision. Things are moving. There's a lot going on. The future is incredibly exciting. And not just as to focused on just one organ, but the impact of this and the collaborations with cardiology, nephrology, all the other areas within the overall school of medicine, and beyond the school of medicine with school of engineering, pharmacy, nursing, et cetera. I think hopefully this will be continue to be transformative for our institution. And what I would like to finish with is to really finish with where we started. And this is a quote from Peter Buckley, who was then dean, when we got this whole journey started, where he said, bringing the power of medicine, technology, engineering, sociology, economics, business, and justice to leverage the central role of the liver in health to avoid suffering and save lives worldwide. And that's our mission. We will stay true to that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We can take any questions here first.
You know, I'm just an ICU doc, and I take care of a lot of these liver patients. And alcohol is the number one cause why so many of these folks end up here. And so, you know, alcohol and metabolism interact obviously. What part of alcohol in specific, because, you know, that starts off with psychiatric, that starts off basically with brain and neurology. How do you see that fitting into the entire program?
So we are already, we have several programs in alcohol. We didn't have enough time to cover all of this. So we are funded through NIAAA. To look at multiple aspects of alcohol-related liver disease. But we are also working with Dr. Moeller, towards particularly as we come upon the renewal of our NIAAA, to be able to link the behavioral elements and their care and science related to the behavioral parts of the disease to the end organ part of the disease. So that's one part of, you know, what's going is the integration of alcohol use disorder along with the end organ disease management. And number two is we think there are very specific aspects of alcohol-related liver disease because those patients frequently are far more jaundiced than, you know, other types of severe liver disease. And when you get severely jaundiced, it's cholestatic jaundice, so you can't get the bile out of the liver. So it regurgitates and gets conjugated, so it's becoming more water soluble. And so the kidneys have to deal with the burden of very toxic bile acids going through. And this population is particularly set up for AKI. So we're developing a slew of research programs around this idea of how the cholestatic process, and Saul actually, when he gets here, will be, this is one of the areas that he's particularly interested in as well. I think there are a lot of additional opportunities in terms of ICU care, as we were talking about earlier. There's this concept that if you just measure a lactate and look at the MELD and the lactate on day one and on day three, if you cannot wash out your lactate by 30%, 33%, if you don't have a 33% drop in your lactate within 48 hours, that identifies the population, that's not going to do well. Whereas the rest actually do quite well if you can get them over the hump. And this may actually help us further fine-tune, refine, you know, who should move towards transplant on an urgent basis and where we can actually take time to medically stabilize the patient and then figure out what's the right answer for that patient. So this is an area of great unmet need. And what we are seeing now is that the average patient is a young female frequently. Whereas when I was in training, it was a 60, 70 year old man with 50 years of alcohol history. So the disease has changed. We don't fully understand why a lot of these young people are getting sicker. So one of the things that we are starting, I'm working on a protocol, is to take all the explants from these very young people who have very severe disease and to be able to use spatial transcriptomics and do some biomarker work on that. Comparing them to the old, we're still seeing some older patients coming in to see whether we're talking, you know, because we just look at the phenotype. So you drink alcohol, you're jaundiced, we think it's all one disease, but maybe it's not. Maybe there's a different some biology in these young people, because it's hard for me to reconcile that there's been so much increase in alcohol consumption that by the mid-20s, you're wiped out your liver, because, you know, most people start drinking in teenage years, right? And whereas alcohol's been around for a very long time, and the time when people started drinking hasn't really changed. So something else has changed. And so we're trying to figure that out. So I think there are a lot of things that we can do in this space.
I have a comment and a very broad question. So first of all, thank you to you and the incredible team that has put this together and works so well with the University and the health system. It's just a gem because we're looking at patients like sometimes you can person in your efforts. I've seen them at kind of one season. And my other question is, I mean, we have this tremendous resource and we have a lot of young physicians and trainees in the environment. So the best way for them to get started in an academic career to build off what you have here, whether it's liver or with other disciplines. Maybe you can share one or two people from around the department, like you're looking at how others might be involved. Like, I think it's a great opportunity for your faculty.
Yeah, you know, that is such an important question. I personally think we're still lagging because we've been building infrastructure. We haven't really focused in it in a major way. But what I would envision is we need a chief of professional development to spearhead, because there's so much to do. You run out of hours every day. You should know this, how that works. I would envision engagement with people even when through the whole entire life cycle, right? So from the time people are applying for med school, when people arrive in med school, when people are applying for internship and residency, once they arrive in residency. So many students, residents, et cetera, don't even know what we're doing, that we exist and what we do. And, you know, and they may have misperceptions of what liver disease is, and they think it's some siloed little very niche specialty, but the broader impact of this on ICU care, on cardiovascular disease, chronic kidney disease, neurocognitive decline, cancers, you know, these are not fully maybe appreciated. So there's an opportunity through, you know, resident morning meetings, et cetera, to, you know, beyond just the everyday things that we do, like case discussions, et cetera, in those morning reports, is also have some mechanism for the house staff to be more aware of all the incredibly exciting things that, A, that are going on right here, B, that they can participate in and engage with faculty. Most of the faculty are very open to having residents and interns coming in and talk to them. Some of it is a bandwidth issue because we're all of us trying to do a lot of different things. So as we continue to scale up, hopefully we will be able to have a more structured way of doing this. I would love to see a formal curriculum around basics of cell biology. You know, you don't have to become a cell biologist, but we want even our clinicians to be scholarly and have enough understanding of some of these basic biological processes. For junior faculty, I think it's a resource, right? It should be part of the, when junior faculty come to interview, you know, that they should know that there's a CTSA, there's a Liver Institute, there's a Poly Heart Center, you know, there's Massey Cancer Center. There are many resources within the ecosystem. And so don't want this to be just all about the liver, but I think having those type of some mechanism to orient all new faculty who are or faculty people who are looking at us as a place to come and build a career. So they know that there's all these different things happening. And it's a really exciting time for VCU and the School of Medicine, I think. We have a comprehensive cancer center. We have a fantastic heart center, which is on an up trajectory. We have a liver institute. You know, there's so much going on. We have this incredible program on autonomic dysfunction that, you know, is a very challenging area. So neurosciences is growing. So I think those are all opportunities that we could.
Thank you. like to echo Dr. Sainz that congratulations, really huge, you know, accomplishments in a short period of time. I saw that part of your vision is to open SSLI branches in other countries. Can you expand a little bit upon how would that be operating?
Well, it's a vision right now, right? You know, Cleveland Clinic has a footprint in the Middle East. You know, once we develop our own care pathway and paradigms. So I am much more, having worked, one of the things I've learned working with pharma industry on many trials and working with their leadership is the value of intellectual property, which traditionally academics don't really understand. And even when they understand, they don't know how to actually use it. And so once we develop the kind of care paradigms and care pathways, we will protect our IP through all of this. And once we can show that the care pathways and the kind of technologies we integrate into our care pathways are resulting in better outcomes, then we can actually bring those paradigms, because everybody's looking for better outcomes, right? And so we can leverage some of our collaborations. We already have a global footprint. We know people all over the world. And so we can leverage those to extend our clinical reach in a more formal way, which of course, you know, also allows us to expand the visibility of VCU, which is part of a larger mission.
About a year ago, you wrote an article about the name change from non-alcoholic diabetes to metabolic association with fatty liver disease. And I think that's really important, especially in the HIV population that we have in the community, that we are seeing now this shift toward MAFLD in our patients as well. And so what type of, you know, opportunities or research are you doing in the HIV population? Because we're seeing a tremendous amount of weight gain from our meds, just long-standing HIV, and MAFLD is common in patients as well.
So Richard Sterling is, like I said, our paradigm is every place has a point person. So Richard is our point person. We actually have a NIH-funded study for people who have steatotic liver disease, who have HIV and have steatotic liver disease that we are part of. So Richard would be the person to talk to. But something that I would be very interested in is actually talk, if we have folks from the, who are managing the HIV population, who are interested in collaborating to do some more fundamental science on what's happening with this metabolism. It's been neglected because anytime you have a condition which sits in between two specialties, nobody takes ownership, right? Because in the if you're an infectious disease doc, then you're thinking, you know, this is metabolism, this is not what I do. And the metabolic person says, that's sort of all HIV, you know, this is not my diabetes or whatever. But I think that's, there's some very interesting data that these HIV population, their clock genes are reset in their brain. And so the release of IGF-1, which is insulin-like growth factor 1, which is an important regulator of visceral adipose tissue, is altered. So you actually get suppression of the normal pulsatile IGF-1 release, and you get lower IGF-1, which is associated with expansion of visceral adipose tissue. So there is a drug called tesamorelin, which is now approved for visceral adiposity in HIV. Which essentially leverages this. It's a growth hormone release hormone. It's a synthetic GHRH. And so we work with them, for example, already in, you know, we're helping develop a, see whether that can be used in garden variety, visceral adiposity. In Asia, where people are generally lean, but they have expansion of the visceral adipose tissue, a molecule like tesamorelin could be potentially very useful, but we would love to study this in more detail, you know, because we have a human metabolic chamber, we can do clamps, we can do all kinds of things that most other people cannot. And so we'd love to talk more about some of those opportunities.
Thank you so much, appreciate it. Robert.
Thank you.
I have a quick question. Yeah.
So I, 20 years ago, I was at the NIH and studied metabolism with Dr. Richard Beach, who worked with Ms. Krebs. They developed the IV ketone ester.
He passed away
a couple of years ago. But we have a project now, actually, with a pharmacy that developed this IV ketone ester for exogenous ketone therapies. Mm-hmm. Being thought about for ischemic states, such as strokes, but there is a lot of, like you talked about, the type 3 diabetes, dementia.
Exactly.
Very fascinating work. Phil Girk in the School of Pharmacy and Pharmaceutics is the person that we kind of handed that off to, since I'm all clinical. But love to try to connect some way. I don't know that it's right now, but it'd be super
maybe
fascinating
the first
to talk
quarter,
about.
First quarter would be love to sit down and
yeah, I'd love to kind of update you guys. And I know Centera is also very interested in the project.
And then with the ketones, you know, there's a whole idea about the biology of ketones as antifibrotics and anti-inflammatory. The ketogenic diets have spurred a lot of that science.
Yeah, this is a difference. The researcher, Dr. Beach, was very passionate about exogenous ketones.
Yeah, because this is going
to
happen.
Anyways, fascinating conversation. We'd love to connect sometime next year. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Good stuff. You know, that's the stuff that gets us all excited.
Yeah, it's really exciting. And thank you so much. Appreciate your time.
Hopefully, that was okay.
It was wonderful. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Was that on time?
Yeah, we have 15 minutes for conversation.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Absolutely.